Okay, if you don't mind, we will start, and our colleague Mara Mourinho will join us. There's some delay, but I don't want to keep everybody waiting. So if you don't mind, let's begin. Good morning, everybody. I welcome all who joined us today for the discussion. I'm Vice Rector of Research of the Diplomatic Academy, Oleg Ivanov. Today, we're going to speak about challenges and priorities for international politics from past to future. We decided to focus on three questions. The first one sounds like, what event or trend most significantly influenced international relations in 2020? The second one, what event or trend is expected to become the most important one in international relations in 2021? And the last one, what do you think states and the world community should do to prevent crisis and to promote cooperation in the future? For the discussion, we invited three distinguished scholars and experts from different countries, and let me introduce them to you. The first one is Rolf Blauberg, CEO, Intercultural Forum Company, member of the Foreign Policy Association, Zurich, Switzerland. The second speaker is Alexander Lambert, Academic Director and founding member of the Geneva Institute of Geopolitical Studies, Geneva, Switzerland. The third one is Andre Molot, Associate Professor of the Department of International and National Security of the Diplomatic Academy, Moscow. We expect to join us Mara Marini, Associate Professor at the Department of Political Science, University of Genoa, Italy. And the last but not least, James Scher, Senior Fellow of the Estonian Foreign Policy Institute at the International Center for Defense and Security, Tallinn, Estonia, OHP, Associate Fellow of the Russia and Eurasia Program, Royal Institute of International Affairs, Chatham House, London, the UK. I welcome all our participants, and before I turn it over to you, I'd like just to remind you that we have a time limit for each speaker of 5 minutes, and after each round, after each question, we'll have time for questions and exchange of views among experts and from the audience. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to our first speaker, Rolf. Can you hear me?
Yes, okay.
Please.
Okay, so I'm happy to present here, and I have some charts to show, and I hope it works to give up the freedom. There. Okay, I hope you see my chart now.
Yes.
Okay, then let's start us. So the ideas and principal deductions on internal politics. And according to your three questions, the first impact is the impact of the pandemic in the last year. And I think this year has already started very negatively with the US-China meeting in Alaska. And then of course, I think totally, what we have, the big problem is really the global fight of the USA to keep its dominant position and what to do is that this goes over really peacefully. So if we look at the pandemic, it's very clear what came out of it. What was clearly visible is the very strong dependence of world supply chains on products from China. Our shops were already empty at a time when there was no pandemic in Switzerland, but the products didn't come again anymore because China was not working. China is really took over in principle. If you look at 2000, Japan was the central supply hub for Asia. Now it's China, very clearly. And it's stronger than the US here. We have the same, if we go to more, that was a bit too much. The same if we go to the more global complex value chains. And the problem, of course, is if we see it here, United States is, of course, still the strongest importer in the world, so very important for many countries. But China is already the second importer, and China is the first exporter, and the United States the second one. In total, China has taken over the position of the US as the most important trading partner. And we see also something like this in the global domestic product evaluation. China is strictly catching up against the US and Europe, considering the global GDP. And if you look at the purchasing power parity, it has already surpassed the values for US and the European Union in 2014. So there is really something which is disturbing the present power, not so much the European Union, but mainly the United States of America. And we have seen this again in the US-China meeting in Alaska on the 19th and 20th of this month, where the US Secretary of State Antony Blinken and his delegation met the Chinese delegation led by Chinese Communist Party Foreign Affairs Chief Yang Jiechi. It was a very, very unsuccessful meeting. In principle, the meeting started with a strong attack from US side on democracy and human rights in China, and a strong counterattack from Chinese side, referring to recent human rights issues and democracy issues within the United States of America. The Chinese very sharp reaction is highly untypical for Chinese politicians. It does not fit China's political culture. So in principle, this sharp reaction is in principle a clear point that China is very, very annoyed and willing to really strongly counterattack from the US now. If we want to understand this, we have to see what was going on in 1999. Here we have the US. Total external trade in US dollar. And here was China. China is very, very small in comparison to the US. 2018, both have strongly grown, but China is now the larger one. But what is much more interesting and more important is, in 1999, 191 countries had more trade with the US than with China. Only 20 countries have more trade with China. In 2018, it has been turned around. Only 84 countries had more trade with the US than China, and 140 countries had more trade with China. So the US is really challenged in its leading position. And if we look at the closer picture, we see something very interesting. Here, this is China in 1998. It's trade of the US with other countries. Canada is the most important. Mexico, the second neighbor, is the second important. In 2018, China is the most important trading partner for the US, and the neighbors are not so longer that important, but it's still important. And another point here, 50% of the total US trade is going with this four countries. If you look at China, we see the opposite. We had a quite strong concentration here in 1999 on a few countries. Now we have a broad distribution. These numbers decrease, the percentage decrease. So it's more spread out, the whole trade.
Rolf, I'm sorry, 1 minute is left.
Sorry?
1 minute is left.
Okay. So let's get to the next step. The global fight of the USA to keep its dominant position. We had already in the US over the last 70 years, US was the only economic superpower, challenged now by China. US was the world war technology leader. First challenged in 1957 with Sputnik by the USSR, now challenged by China. US was the most influential power after the Soviet Union also challenged by China. US was the only military power after the breakdown of the Soviet Union, now challenged by Russia. We have computer systems. USA is losing. China had in 2013 the fastest computer in the world, still using Intel processor. Reaction, President Obama banned the sales of corresponding Intel processors to China. Now, we are in 2016, they reaction, they built a new supercomputer completely with Chinese components. We see the list of top 500 computers. The US is going down the percentage, China is going up. This is important because this is not what they produce, this is where they use it. So China is using these computers for its technology development, for its production systems. So this is a very important shift. It gives a lot of power for doing new products, creating new products in the US. Also, we have something else, which is the Chinese university international ranking. Chinese catching up strongly. For the first time, we have Tsinghua University under the first 20. Usually, all the top 10 and so are US and Great Britain university. This has changed substantially now. This is not unimportant, it's very important for the US because usually about 40% of the PhDs given in the US are given to students who are not US citizens and who do not have a green card. So it's with short-term visa. Under Donald Trump, there were a lot of them were sent back. And now we also have the position that universities in China are very good now. They have a lot of development and improvement in education. And so students may no longer be interested to go to the US and stay in China. So what is going on? The USA is strategy to keep its dominance, engage allies to attack and constrain China and Russia, NATO allies, European Union plus other countries, mainly against Russia. Nord Stream 2, we have here trying to kill international projects with Russia. Australia, Japan, and India against China. There was the so-called virtual Quad Summit, security dialogue on March 12th. So it's a clear situation. The US is looking for its ally to constrain the power of China and Russia. And this is a situation which is not simply something which will go away because it's the philosophy of the political elite within the US. If you think about Zbigniew Brzezinski, he was a counselor to US President Lyndon B. Johnson. He was security advisor to US President Jimmy Carter. And in 1997, he had a book, The Grand Chessboard, American Primacy and its Geostrategic Imperatives. He compares several old empires, Mongol, China, most only in the Asian area. Geostrategic analysis of the situation up to 1996-97. Conclusion, USA must strongly lead the world until the world is ripe for a more cooperation system. We have a very similar point with Henry Kissinger. He was also security advisor to US President Richard Nixon and Gerald Ford, and he was Secretary of State 1973 to 1977. His book, World Order, published in 2014, has a very, very similar point than those of Brzezinski. It comes to the conclusion, the US must lead the world. This is the philosophy of the US political establishment. And that's what we have to take into account when we discuss solutions to the present situation. If you look into history, we never had a situation that a global power was there and was losing its position. Very, very rare event. Regional powers, yes, that happened several times. And all the times, in principle, it was at least the consequence was trade wars and very often a real war. So the situation is really tricky and dangerous. And the point is, if we want to reduce stress, we have to really do a lot to build up understanding between the US and the other countries, and to make it easier for the US to accept that other countries are coming up and getting more important. If we are not able to do this, there will be no good situation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rolf. Thank you for your presentation. Can you switch off your presentation, please?
Okay, Oleg, can you hear me?
Alexander, are you ready?
Yes.
Yes, please, go ahead.
Okay.
Alexander, don't forget about 5 minutes, okay?
Yeah, okay, I understand, yeah. Thank you for your kind invitation so that I can be part of this interesting discussion, because we really talk about very important issues of world politics at this moment. And so I shortly reply. And most of what I will say will overlap with Rolf's presentation for sure. I just allow myself to complete the picture in my own 5 minutes spectrum. The first question, in my view, there are two things that have marked last year. The one is for sure the global pandemic, COVID-19, and especially the economically destructive side effects that it has had all over the world, and caused by multiple lockdowns, something that we have never seen in world history since historiography is recorded. The second one is the US elections. The US elections has had a terrific impact on international affairs, especially on international dialogue that would radiate far beyond the US. While the main problem for the US was internal division along ideological lines and ethnic lines that has protracted and severed those divisions, unfortunately, that has brought the United States at the brink of a civil war, has had also unfortunate side effects on international relations, especially the potentially top important strategic dialogue with Russia. And as you know, as the Democratic Party always has blamed Trump for having been engaged in some sort of covert operation surrounding his own election, Russiagate, and other things. This has really not helped the international affairs since. Then the second question is kind of tied together. Let's say the protracted COVID-19 lockdown measures. We are now entering a phase where we will see millions and millions of small and medium-sized enterprises bankrupted, starting with Europe and the USA, but also the rest of the world. And the situation in developing countries dramatic, because they also will suffer from one of the severest food insecurity crises that they have ever seen in their history. Then what is very important now after the election is how the Biden administration is coping with China. I have nothing to add. Rolf told everything, but let me say that this is really the clue for world peace at this point. And then what I would like to add in a perspective, and since we have the possibility to discuss everything, is what is now called the Great Reset. This is the third topic. The Great Reset has been announced by the World Economic Forum already last year, and that we will have to look into perhaps a bit more concretely this year. And there has been a lot of talks and discussions commenced on this particular subject matter that by accident or not, perfectly coincides with the COVID-19 pandemic crisis and the economic destruction, I can't tell another word, and which would ultimately lead to an accelerated digitization of the economy all around the world. Whether we want or not, this is another question, but all of the influential circles surrounding the World Economic Forum apparently are set to really digitize the world economy massively over the next years. The third question is then, of course, what shall be done? I now borrow an idea that has been put forth by the Schiller Institute in Berlin, and which is perfectly a very good strategic idea. We need some sort like a high-level global task force composed of 3 to 4 major powers, United States, China, and Russia, and perhaps India. By India, because this is very important for in the perspective of the 21st century as we march into a new era of international affairs. It's a very important to have the most important perspective emerging economy in the world on the board. And since India-China relations will be the most detrimental litmus test of peace and stability and economic development in the 21st century. Then what I would like to say is that we need a new paradigm in international affairs, talk about international relations in a different manner that we have been doing so in the 20th century. And China actually paves the way in suggesting a new form of generation of leadership that is indirectly promoted along the Belt and Road Initiative that he's launching, an initiative which has very often been misunderstood as a kind of geopolitical confrontation or against established Western powers, but which is absolutely not the case. And there is way small leverage and leeway for Western powers to participate in this century project than anything else, which ultimately is nothing than development, peace project. Peace through development is actually the baseline and is something that focuses on large-scale infrastructure development, especially in transition and developing countries, something that has really been neglected for decades by established international financial and development institutions, so to say. Then we need a kind of avoid a new Cold War II situation in between US and China and prevent World War III. This is very important also in regards to the relations between US and Russia in Europe. We need also that we transcend this old zero-sum conceptualization of international relations that was typical for the Cold War, but there's now it is completely relevant because China is not set to engage in such a pseudo Cold War attitude, like, for instance, the very highly ideological discourses that we had in between the West and the former Soviet Union. She's not interested in ideological things. And so, and competition whatsoever, which is interested in cooperation. Now, if I can say a last thing, then hopefully I'm bad. This all needs a lot of new confidence building measures among the great powers to facilitate a constructive dialogue. So, can you hear me? Can you all hear me? So what was this, the last thing? That's it. I don't want to say more at this point. Thank you so much for giving me 5 minutes. Everything else will be later. Thank you so much.
Yeah. We have 2 more questions to answer later, so we'll have time. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Well, I'd like to ask everybody, please, if you don't speak, switch off your microphones, okay?
Okay, I understand. Yeah.
Okay, as Professor Mori is not with us so far, I'd like to turn it over to Andrei Malo.
Yes, hello everyone. Can you hear me?
Philip, can you speak up, please?
Yes, I'll try. Can you hear me now?
Oh, yes.
Okay. So, question number one, event and trend of the last year. First, about the event. It is a very simple but very significant event which happened on the margins of the last year and this year. Despite the vivid deterioration of the relations between the West and Russia, between the West and China, This is a very important positive element. I want to stress now, despite all these deteriorations, and that is the prolongation of 2010 Prague SALT Treaty, unconditional prolongation. Why it is important? First, it is a vivid example of the gained balance of strategic interests of different and sometimes opposing each other countries. And it could be used as a positive example for others. Number two, prolongation is not a matter of concessions on one side towards the other side. Actually, it is a gained balance of interests, and the balance of interest is preserved, which is also a very good example. Strategically, the necessary level of transparency and predictability between two biggest nuclear powers still will be preserved, which is in the interests of all over the world. Fourthly, prolongation of the treaty is in fact the appearance of possible preconditions, future preconditions for the turning point, if it is probably possible really, in a menacing tendency of deteriorating and dismantling of political diplomatic mechanisms of ensuring the international security. So it could be really used as a turning point if there will be a political will. So in fact, summing it up, a window of opportunity has been opened for possible practical steps in the arms control, but not only for USA and Russian Federation, but for others and in different spheres. As Anthony Blinken, and with this I could agree with him, says this is the, I quote, not an end, but the beginning of history, end of quote. So I hope that the strategic dialogue will be preserved, and that will be the topic of my second question. As for the trend, the situation is much more complex. The biggest trend, which is at the same time could be considered as a very deteriorating and dangerous and menacing trend, is the ideologization of international relations. Ideologization of international agenda with the aim of regained dominance of certain powers, in fact USA, at the expense of the containment of other countries. That is the principal formula of ideologization, which is being conducted now and actually fulfilled and used in full. The fact that the world has been changed with the new centers of power with which appeared with their interest has pushed the dominance of Western allies, namely the USA political class, under the question, coupled with the political system crisis in the USA themselves as a leader of Western civilization manifested during the election campaign, the trend of losing the influence over the globalization process is making these allies being more and more nervous and sometimes even unpredictable. An unprecedented case of name calling and insulting rhetorics of one leader towards another leader is a vivid example of this convulsive policy and this nervousness. Or it is a staged event. That is a good question. If it is a staged event insulting another leader, that could be considered as a vivid manifestation of a trend to mobilize the allies and the West in their strategic fight against Russian Federation and China, which oppose the so-called rules order the world based on rules, certain rules which are being shaped by someone and which are being shaped for the interests of someone, which do not actually clear for the time being. So the question is, where is the real politics? Where is the followers of Kissinger, Schlesinger, Marx von Lane, where are the followers of Helmut Schmidt and Giscard d'Estaing? We have, instead of the real politics, have what we're witnessing now is that we're witnessing the promotion of concrete geopolitical economic, financial interests nicely camouflaged in an ideological box. That is a very menacing and very destabilizing trend. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor, for your presentation. Now I'd like to turn it over to James Scher. Scher, James, are you ready?
I am ready. Всем доброе утро. Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. You would expect me to answer the first question by stating that the impact of the COVID pandemic has been the major theme of 2020. And I'd love to disappoint you, but I won't. And I won't contradict that. But I want to make some points that are not immediately intuitive or obvious. First, the impact of the pandemic has not been what many originally supposed or hoped. It suspended the dynamics of geopolitical competition, nor has it altered them. It has simply been incorporated into existing dynamics, patterns, and lines of cleavage. If anything, in many respects, the pandemic has underscored and reinforced them. And stating this, by the way, I am only stating what several close interlocutors of mine have said in the Russian Higher School of Economics and the Council of Foreign and Defense Policy, certainly highly amongst the most established intellectual institutions that can be found in Russia. One or two very brief examples. Growing unpleasantness between Russia and the EU over, and please tell me this, I've seen this printed in both ways. Do you call it Sputnik V or Sputnik Piat or Sputnik V in Russia, Oleg?
I'm not sure.
Okay. All right. But here's an example where between Europe and Russia, it's not produced greater cooperation, it's produced greater nastiness, often of a petty kind. Interestingly, and this is a change, the impact of Brexit on the UK has been disastrously negative until it became clear, first, that Britain is performing in an exemplary fashion with regard to its own vaccination program, and the EU has been making a shambles. And that is likely to reinforce, certainly contrary to my own inclinations, support for Brexit in Britain. I can think of only one significant case where the COVID pandemic has altered important outcomes. And not everyone would agree with me, but my own view is that had Donald Trump not so disastrously and extravagantly misperceived the implications and the seriousness and the reality of this pandemic, that he probably would have won re-election and not lost to Joseph Biden. And I am not the only I would not be the only person, even amongst American colleagues, in supporting that conclusion. But I would say, and I'm reiterating the point, for the elites and for the people, certainly in the Western world, and I think in Russia as well, and I think in China as well, the elites and people who think about and make policy, the main issues remain the same. We have touched on We have touched on one of them a great deal, which is China. Russia remains an extremely important issue for all the key players, and obviously for Russia itself. And although it's not stated, I think in the Kremlin, there is a great sense of affirmation that even if Russia is disliked, it is still considered to be so profoundly important for what we call the West. So just to conclude on a note of repetition, in sum, I think what 2020, despite the pandemic, has demonstrated is the underlying tenacity of the key issues that challenge us and divide us, with the exception that it has possibly introduced more divisions by the end of the year than what we had started with. And I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Jay, thank you very much for your contribution. Now we have around 10 minutes for questions from the audience and experts, of course, and exchange of views. But I'd like to ask you that if someone would like to comment on or make a point, please limit your commentary to maybe 1-2 minutes, okay? So I open the floor for questions and comments.
Can I ask a question, please?
Yes, if you allow me. Please forget to introduce yourself.
Okay. Well, my name is Maria. I am a first year student of a master's degree in international relations of Diplomatic Academy. And I would like to address my question to Dr. Klauberg. But I believe that every speaker can join and answer this question as one way or another. Each speaker addressed the issue of the relations within the strategic triangle, and by strategic triangle, I mean the relations between Washington, Moscow, and Beijing. Because as Mr. Dr. Klauberg accurately mentioned, that the meeting between between the USA and China went very bad, and there was just yesterday a meeting between China's and Russia's foreign ministers in China, and it seemed to be very smooth and to seem to be to go very smooth and well. Actually, can this shift end up in a disbalance in this triangle and lead to the new round of confrontation like it was in the worst years of Cold War? That is my question.
So the question is whether it's getting worse or better, or
can this shift like end up in a worsened relations between China and Russia and Washington and USA and be like in the worst years of Cold War?
Well, I think partly I would say because they are already close in the Cold War. See, topic, we are maybe even going more to a hot war. The danger is there. I think the danger is simply because there is no trust between the countries. Everyone is afraid of the other one. Everyone seems to attack the other countries. And the main problem, of course, is what I said already. It is the situation that America is losing its position as the dominant force. Be careful. This will be, it still is the dominant force, but the other ones are catching up. But nevertheless, US gets very nervous through this point and feels attacked, and then it reacts. This is the situation principle. And I'm not sure what I can do to improve the situation so that the US is not feeling attacked anymore and really behaves more serious and does not see enemies at every corner. They are always using arguments like democracy and human rights, but see the Chinese reaction to this. What we have seen in human rights and democracy in the US in the last period, when the change of from Donald Trump to Joe Biden was not a good example for them.
Thank you, Rolf. If anybody would like to add something, I mean, the participants, you're welcome.
Hello, dear professors.
Just a minute. I'm sorry. I'm asking the participants if anybody, I mean, the speakers, would like to add. Yes, James, you please.
I think perspective is important. If you go back to what some of us have been writing since 2014, indeed since 2008, I can think of some earlier dates, then you would have seen some of us, including me, suggesting that in some respects, even then, the present dynamics and configuration in Europe simply regarding Russia was more dangerous than that of the Cold War, in part because the demarcation line between what is West and what is Ruski Mir, considered to be the Russian world and its supposed zone of influence, has moved considerably to Russia's disadvantage. So there is a historical context to all of these things. And I would also say, it's not an opinion I think would be supported by most of the other participants here, that the ideological factor, the values issue, the issue of what Russia increasingly, starting early in this century, has been calling the civilizational factor in international relations, has been present for a long time, and at times exceptionally vocal and needlessly vocal and destructively vocal. So all of this did not happen yesterday. It didn't start with 2020. That's all I wanted to say.
Thank you, James.
Can I add something?
Yes.
Very, very short.
Alexander, I saw you. I gave you the floor next. I've done great.
Okay. Very short. I think the if the deterioration process prevail, and I think that it would prevail, unfortunately, the number one hostage will be Europe. And all of us understands that. It was the case several times during the history, which we know. It's number one. Number two is that despite the efforts to establish military contacts on the borderline, on the line of contacts between Russia and NATO, practically no result has been achieved. And this is a very, very menacing signal. So we do not have regular contacts between military experts for deconflicting to avoid unnecessary clashes on the borderline. And that could be really very dangerous, because the logic of raising the conflicting potential has its own logic. And I think the political will, despite all differences, despite the differences in the value systems, the common sense should prevail to establish professional contacts to avoid real practical clashes and crises. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Alexander, do you want to say something?
You're muted. No.
Microphone is on. Can you hear me? I hear.
Yes.
I would like to thank the question posed by Maria. And as I'm myself a professor of international relations, a civilian, I'm not advising governments and certainly not great powers. I talk here as a civilian and on behalf of my students, the next generation, if you want. What the next generation is looking for is a paradigm shift, so simple. We need to reinvest in diplomacy. They're important. The US has tremendously militarized international relations culture by militarizing foreign policy all over the world. This is a zero-sum end programmed. So we need investment, diplomacy, and then perhaps the paradigm shift should go away from confrontational attitude and look for win-win. So put aside zero-sum scenarios and invest in win-win scenarios. Make strategic foresight, not just geopolitical, but also geoeconomic. Very important. Geoeconomics, Rolf has just explained, give a good example. We don't look into it, the hard data. We have to look into realities on the ground and not just play ideologization like Mr. Ivanov has said. We have to do something concrete, look into evidence-based data to explore not just the world peace, but also why not invest in student careers? Because if you go out of the classroom and learn about realism, liberalism, that kind of stuff, you don't learn nothing, okay? You need to learn languages, learn skills, right? And learn negotiation. And then perhaps to make an icebreaker, if you allow me, because you don't want to over-dramatize, but that's what we need. You know, we need, instead of kickboxing skills and kung fu and karate, we need kind of tai chi or aikido type attitudes, so that the spirit and the soul is coming with, you know, power plays. Perhaps it will be to the benefit of the next generation. That's what they look for. That's okay. Because our assessment, if you're doing geopolitics, is always the same thing. Arms race, arms control, balance of power, kind of big things. People are not interested in the street in this kind of shit. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Alexander. We have time for one more question. Yep. Quick question, please, Galina. Yes, please go ahead.
Hello, thank you, professors, for your presentation. And I'm a student of master degree, and I currently study in Taiwan. So I represent the East side. And if we take into consideration that before the meeting between the U.S. and Alaska, the U.S. and China in Alaska, the U.S. side had two meetings with the allies in Japan and South Korea, and if we can take it as a shift to alignment with South Korea and Japan in terms of taking relationship with China, I have one question to Professor Kloberg. So what approach would Europe consider the best for dealing with China's economic growth? And also, could you comment on the sanctions in the wake of the meeting that was in Alaska? Because there were a lot of topics considering the human rights in Xinjiang region. And like in the wake of this meeting, the European side decided to take sanctions. So in my question to you would be like, if China's economic growth is a challenge or an opportunity for Europe, and how is Europe going to deal with China? And also my second question I would like to address to Professor James. Sorry, I cannot see your surname. So this is in a wake of a common sense of the U.S. decline in terms of dealing with pandemic and also decline in democracy in a way that we see like Capitol incidents and also Black Lives Matter movement. And as you have just mentioned, the values as the core point of for like as a new trend in 2021, and we consider it like the core point in the international relations, who should be the leader of the values in the world, and like who should we look after? Thank you very much, professors.
Okay, considering the situation, China and European Union or Europe, yes, of course, there's also strong competition there, but there's also still a lot of interaction, because China is a big market for the European Union and for countries in the European Union. So it is very important. For example, Switzerland has a lot of activities going on with China. And it's one of, if you look at the data, it's surprisingly a big trading partner of China, especially in the areas of technology. And that's one of the interesting points. You see, Switzerland is also considered a high-tech company, high-tech country, and China is also reaching this state now. So there's a lot of activity going on. If you compare this at the moment with Russia, the European Union and Russia, the exchange of the trade is in principle. From Russia, the European Union gets nearly only 60% of everything it gets is raw materials, oil and gas mainly, energy, not processed. 90% of the products which are going from the European Union to Russia are high-tech industrial products. So there's a very strict imbalance in what we European Union is selling to Russia and what Russia is selling to the world. I would say what is really important would be if Russia also would more improve its technology side, not just the military technology, but really general technology, and really become a trading partner in all of this aspect, and not just someone which is from the economic part, not very interesting for most of the countries. Germany is still a strong trading partner with Russia, correct. And there are a lot of interest in Germany to do this. But for most of the other countries, if you look at the numbers simply, Russia is economically not very interesting, not very strong in the world economy. China is, and that's the big difference. And if you look, of course, the relations between China and Russia, both are in the our neighbors on the Asian continent. And of course, if you look for the book for Brzezinski, one danger he was envisioned for US policy and US dominance was that Russia will be too weak economically to be on its own feet and will be pressured to collaborate strongly with China. And that would lead to a so-called Eurasian superpower. And that was one of the things he was warning the US against. And especially when Ukraine was taken away from the Soviet Union, was not staying with Russia. He was against this, surprisingly, because he said Russia is becoming too weak. And therefore, there's a danger that Russia will be pressured, will be forced to collaborate strongly with China and not with the West.
Thank you, Rolf. Now, James, I'd like to go to you. There is a question for you.
I know the clock is ticking, and so, Galina, I hope I answer part of your very comprehensive questions in subsequent contributions. But just to clarify two things, if I may. What I'm trying to emphasize is that this idealization and role of values is not new. And one small nuance, you referred to the decline of democracy in the United States. I would characterize the extraordinary reaction by a core of Trump's supporters to his electoral defeat in different terms. I would say, and in fact, I would say also about much of the whole Trump phenomenon, that what it has demonstrated is not a decline of democracy in the United States, but its vulnerability. It had been assumed by so many, not only in the United States, but in Europe, that everything one associates with liberal democracy was firm and solid in the United States and would remain so, even if it's challenged in Europe, as it has been. Look at, by comparison, the scale, the intensity, and the temper of the whole Yellow Vest movement in France, of the types of mass demonstrations that occurred over Catalonia. The United States is not alone. This is not a 2020 phenomenon. What we have been discovering over the years, and I would say to Russia's evident pleasure, to a strong sense of what the Germans call Schadenfreude, is that a system that we have not only valued in its own terms, but valued because it was considered inherently stable, may not be as stable as we thought. Mm-hmm. That's part of our challenge. It's a big challenge.
Yes. Thank you, James. Well, now I'd like to move on to the second question, which sounds like what event or trend is expected to become the most important one in international relations in 2021. Again, I'd like to ask the speakers to limit your answer to 5 minutes so we could have more time for discussion and exchange of opinions. And I turn it over to Rolf Blauberg. Rolf, can you hear me?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So in principle, I had already presented all my material because I had the 3 points in one discussion. You didn't see that you wanted to see different points.
I see. If you have nothing to add at this point, I will give the floor to the second speaker, Alexander.
Longer. Yes, the principle, the second one was that what we have in this year is the Alaska meeting at the up to Mao is the most important issue, because it shows simply really that there is an escalation now between the situation, the conditions between the US and China. Up to now, it was just trade. It was still good discussion, not good, but acceptable. And now it really exploded. So that happened just after Donald Trump was no longer president and Joe Biden was back in position. Many had expected, at least not that the position would change, but that the tone would be different. And exactly the opposite happened. That was very disturbing, very unpleasant surprise. So that's why I consider this at the moment an important second point, important event for this year, because it is, the other ones are still in the future. I do not know what will happen there.
Okay, Rolf, thank you for your contribution. Alexander? Are you with us?
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Oh, Oleg, actually, I'm sorry. I was a bit emotional before, but the problem is I actually misunderstood you, because I thought I had 5 minutes for the three questions. So actually, I delivered my answer in 5 minutes to the three questions. So what I can do is, I remember once you told me at the academic diplomatic academy that I had only 10 minutes to speak and I had 70 slides before me. So that was a challenge. But now, unfortunately, I don't have slides, so no problems with that. But what I can say, I can repeat what I said under point two. The 3 points under my dot two are the following one. The first one is the protracted crisis that is fueled by the global pandemic. And in my view, this is truly, really, essentially an economic crisis. It's an economic destruction crisis all over the world at all levels. And especially it's a war, indirectly or not, on the middle class in developed countries, and a terrific war on the poor, the world poor. And so it will leave millions of people really in poverty, in this distress, and also kill a lot of small and medium-sized enterprises, to say the least. So we will only see the real impact of that later this year. But let me say this kind of strange feeling or coincidence is that the global pandemic has almost neatly coincided, even if just time frame, with what the World Economic Forum now has announced since last year as the Great Reset. The Great Reset. And this Great Reset is about to do what, essentially, at the end of the tunnel? It will digitize the economy. So we will go digital, okay? And this is a major move into digitalization of world economy. And I don't want to comment too much now, but I just want to give this in as food for thought. Because if at the end of the day, this is my point, a bit provocative, so if not just my enterprise and my computer and my whatever, my passport and whatever, even e-passport, medical passport is digitalized, but also myself, my body is digitalized, then you start thinking. If you are not that a barcode at the end of the day that can be having no privacy at all, that you won't have democracy anymore, no rule of law, and you will have the total and totalitarian of all surveillance systems the world ever seen. And this is underway not just in China now, with the new tech firms leading all the development. And China is already remote controlled by their own devices. It's also now in very much pushed in the West, in the liberal democracy, the OECD countries, as a restructuring process that neatly coincides with the COVID. The destruction here, the reconstruction there. You see this? Destruction here? Great reset, restructuring. Coincidence or not, that is your own judgment. But we have to keep dialogue open towards these circles. Non-state actors, please. Private sector, non-state actors, very important in national affairs. We cannot just talk about governments. That's too late. Then the third one is US-China strategic dialogue is key geopolitically. But this dialogue has to take into account, as Rolf very much explained, geoeconomics, economic patterns, the reality check of the real world. We cannot run the world with another American century. It's just not going to happen. The American state and is bankrupted. Europe has debt. The money is elsewhere in the world. China has $3 trillion reserve. Has a sovereign wealth fund of over $1 trillion. The Gulf countries have more money in cash than we do have. We have to look into reality check. Multipolarity is the key word. And then we have to reinvest into multilateralism, but multipolar. And the new strategic dialogue between the great, including China, US and Russia. And perhaps India, we have to associate India, because it's the most important prospective market in the world. And so we have to look into this quadrangle and urge them to set up a task force, a world task force, to run international relations in the 21st century, and to eventually change from a zero-sum game posture towards win-win and true opportunity choices, overcome old Cold War dividing perceptions, transform perception into real security threats, talk about them, create confidence-building measures, conflict prevention, invest into diplomacy. We have to train new generation of people who speak foreign languages, move around the world, learn about culture, civilizations, not just whatever, who we say. So we have to reinvest into diplomacy and into the new generation who is simply not interested any further in Cold War attitude, zero sum. And so I can tell you, I teach in Geneva, I have always full classroom all over the world. Nobody is interested in this, nobody. So we have to also take ourselves and account ourselves for the next generation's perspective. We cannot just talk to ourselves. We have to talk to ordinary people on the street. Thank you.
Thank you, Alexander, for your thoughts. Well, Professor Malo, the floor is yours.
Yes, events and trends next year. So I think I as a follow-up of what I said, the event which to my mind could be the most important one is the strategic dialogue between big powers, not between Russia and USA, but between USA and China. And what is interesting, it is going on silently. between other big players. So the strategic dialogue aimed at preserving strategic stability should be continued. That is the MALT event, which is doomed to happen despite all deteriorations, contradictions based on different values, and so on. Speaking about concrete dialogue between Russia and USA, what should be in? First of all, the systems, both nuclear and non-nuclear, which could fulfill strategic tasks. That is number one. Number two, the inherited principle between offensive and defensive weapons should be preserved. Number three, special attention. And that is why I'm stressing this important issue, because of the extremely dangerous situation. We are on the edge of the really hot war. So special attention should be paid to the attack strategic systems, both nuclear and not, which could be used for counter-force first attack with the purpose to neutralize the deterrence capabilities of others. And number four, it should be an expanded strategic dialogue with other issues, including space, cybersecurity. So the bigger formula we will be having, the more we would cover burning issues. So that is could be the most important issue of the next year, I think so. As for the trend, of course, I agree with Alexander saying that there are different, very important trends. One of it is the transition period to a new economic and social order. Plus, another trend, as I mentioned, still going on, ideologization of international relations, even the strategic dialogue, which is very, very menacing and counterproductive. And third, which is a new element, which was already mentioned by Alexander, and I was inclined to mention that as well. This ideologization is coupled with a very dangerous process of raising the potential of global digital information platforms, which are not belonging to states. So in fact, we're having the system when the tail is wagging a dog, and more, and we could find ourselves as an object of manipulation by the big digital platforms. How and what they could do, we saw and we witnessed very clearly during the election and post-election campaign, when they exercised one of the platforms, namely Twitter, exercised the deny of a former President Trump, denying access to Twitter. So that is a clear manifestation of what could be done. So we could, all of us could become the hostages of this rising digital information power. And that should be, of course, the matter of interstate dialogue, because the situation is extremely serious. So this is the main trends which should be controlled and which should be taken into account in the international agenda next year. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Malok. James?
There are lots.
Can you hear me? Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sure.
There are lots of footnotes I would be tempted to add to what we have just heard, but respecting the time clock, I won't. They might come up in questions. I think my co-panelists won't disagree with my first point, that 2021 and even 2022 are likely to be even more dangerous than 2020. But there's one element in this that has not been noted so far. The perception of weakness of the West, weakness of the United States, which has been so eloquently articulated and amplified by our co-panelists, now, as it always has in the past, fueled revisionist policy. fueled a growing confidence in the ability of those who have grievances to take direct and concrete steps to change the status quo. That is also an element in danger. So that would be my first point. My second point is that it is both about saliency, but also about trend, is not surprisingly China. But I want to, instead of simply amplifying and adding to this picture we have seen, which is made literally, graphically persuasive by Rolf Kloberg's diagrams and graphs. I want to raise a question and ask, because I think it will be very important. Is that trajectory going to continue? And there is a question here, because I think until very recently, this trajectory on the part of China and this trend towards economic dominance has occurred in a very quiescent and permissive international environment. And that meeting in Alaska demonstrates very clearly, as less dramatically, the growing consolidation of positions between the United States and its East Asian allies, that this is now going to be challenged. And the question is what happens when it is. Not just how effective can this challenge be and what form it will take, but what the Chinese reaction will be. If you look at that Alaska meeting, my own perception is that there are some very hardcore, tough-minded, non-ideological realists in Biden's administration, but that this was, in a sort of Reaganite way, a sort of opening gambit, a demonstration, a way of saying to everybody, that game is over, a new chapter is beginning. I hope I'm right in saying that, because if it's only an opening gambit, it's not going to continue. And I don't want it to continue in those terms any more than Rolf does or Alexander. But I think also the Chinese reaction is part staged and part not, because I think this has been an entirely new experience to have China's fundamental objectives and its fundamental place in the international system so directly challenged. And there was real indignation in this response. And this is something that China is going to have difficulty getting used to, because even if it doesn't take so ideological a form, I think this challenge is going to grow. And then there's a second question related to China. Can its economic position be transferred into the military domain, and to what degree? And this again is not a silly question. Russia's GDP is largely equivalent to that of Spain. And yet, the West approaches the whole issue of NATO, I should say, not the West. NATO approaches the whole issue of deterring Russia in Europe, of dissuading Russia from taking more militarily aggressive steps in Ukraine and elsewhere, from a very sober and pessimistic point of view, because it's understood that Russia today has a formidable amount of usable military power, and in Syria as well. So you can't make a direct connection between economic strength and this other important barrier. And my final point about 2021 and 2022 has also been discussed. Now, it's been discussed in the language of whether the United States will be able to preserve what's been called its global domination, and that is the main category of analysis in Russia, as well as in this room. But the issue about what one calls domination is very simple. By what means does this domination occur? Does it occur by invitation or by coercion? And I just have to say, it's not a matter of opinion, it is a matter of fact that the retreat of US power in many parts of the world and in many countries provokes apprehension. And that apprehension was extremely visible when Donald Trump, for the first time, started questioning why the United States should be interested in NATO, as if it isn't central to NATO, as if it isn't synonymous with NATO. And this has had deeply unsettling reverberations across the EU. And even in France, the whole agenda of European strategic autonomy has always been fed by the perception that if we face a real crisis, if the apocalypse comes to visit us, the United States might choose not to be there, and what are we going to do? So not all fears about the United States relate to its strength. There are many allies who depend on that strength and want to see more of it and want to see more American power. I don't dispute the fact that there are a number of countries in the world that want to see less of it. But the real question is, and Angela Merkel understands it, and foreign policy and security establishments in most European countries, certainly in Britain, understands it, how much will the Biden administration be able to do to repair the transatlantic relationship, to restore confidence, to restore the trust which has been so grievously damaged? And I don't have an answer to that. No one could possibly answer that today. Thanks.
Thank you, James. You touched upon a broad range of issues. Well, now we have time for about 10 minutes for questions and exchange of views from the audience. Okay. You're welcome. You may use chat. Those who like to prefer written form of question, you're welcome.
Let me make some comment about it. I would like to comment on what Alexander was saying about Russia and the Russian economic position. I think there's one point Russia should be very look into, and this is the way how China became good in its economy. It's not accidental. It's a clear strategy. One is the One Belt, One Road initiative, and the other one is education. The education in China was clearly going, if you look at the universities, which are now considered successfully and in the top league, it's in the field of mathematics, science, technology, and engineering. There was a clear focus on these areas to push technology and to push industrialization of China and science there. And to use this to do international trade and become an international power. So it's not accidental. It's a clear strategy. And sorry, but my impression at the moment is this is missing from the Russian side.
Well, thank you. Anybody else? Question or commentary?
Can I, perhaps?
Yes. Yes, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I wish to thank all of the participants for an excellent panel and an excellent debate and presentations. And the big hello from Belgrade, first of all. But one of the big problems with this 2021 and 2020 is, as Eric Hobsbawm used to put it, 19th century was so eventful, it took him 125 years to end. And it's kind of like this with 2020. So many events happened that we don't really make a concurrent distinction between it and the new year. But my question will be a bit simpler. We've seen the end of 2020, the signing of the regional comprehensive partnership by China and the ASEAN plus countries, which was stated to be one of the biggest trade deal in the world. And on the other side, today we're seeing the initiative kickstarted back by President Biden to have the comprehensive trade and progressive trade agreement of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And we've seen calls by some politicians for the UK to join it and for maybe even America to join it. But what we haven't seen is how these two trade agreements can impact the influence of countries on one another. And Russia is also not in any one of those two. Can she maybe tip the scales if she joined one of, or the other? And that's my general question to the panelists. I don't have a specific member in mind. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Yaroslav, for your question from Belgrade. Well, dear colleagues, experts, would like to take this question. Yes, Alexander.
Thank you very much, and I would like to send back my wishes to Belgrade and from Geneva and from Switzerland. I was not aware what was the name of the gentleman, but I would like to thank him. And my comment more than an answer would be as follows. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is a product of the Obama administration. And it is very often associated with the US pivot to Asia-Pacific region. It's happened, and this was decided in 2010, that the United States would disengage strategically in Europe and the Middle East and would refer 2/3 or 60% of the Navy to the Asia-Pacific in a way to contain China. The Obama administration started in a containment strategy over China. And it's very important step because it's not just the military strategic containment, it's also geoeconomic strategic containment move via the TPP, because the TPP's nickname, you have to understand, is anybody but China. Okay, so it is a provocative treaty that is geopolitical in its, even in its the core. So, and that's why it didn't work. It didn't work. So even India is not interested. So the problem is that where is Russia in all this puzzle, right? $1 million question, was it, yeah, right? So the point is simple. Russia is not necessarily there because there are also other countries that were not deliberately involved, let alone invited. And China has other cooperation programs with Russia along the Belt and Road Initiative and through its strategic partnership renewal. So they have multi-billion dollar cooperation, and Russia is actually benefiting from the fast industrialization process fueled by China along the Belt and Road Initiative. So it's not really a big problem for them, and not for Asia, Eurasia more generally, but it's true that there's some kind, Russia is sometimes missing into strategic free trade agreements as initiated by other great powers, let's say other great powers. But in view of the Chinese-Russian cooperation platform, for the moment, they have very advanced programs, including in the field of technology, not just military technology, but also civilian technology. There's an enormous amount of money invested in the Polar Silk Road, where Russia invests a lot of money to make this new route operational in the forthcoming decades. And it's heavily under support, not just by China, but also by close US allies like Korea. So it is something that we have to look closely into it. I always say to my students, let's put the chapter geopolitics once aside, look into geoeconomics. Draw data from all over the world. What is the geopolitical reality? And with the Belt and Road Initiative, I can tell you, many even Western banks promise that Russia will see almost a rejuvenation of economic development in the near future. There's a huge potential for Russia to redevelop, not just economically, but also come back as a geopolitical superpower, along with China and the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. As you know, even India and Pakistan joined Shanghai in 2017. It's now the greatest regional bloc in the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Alexander. James, would you like to share your thoughts?
I have a question for Alexander. Nina Slav, I don't have the expertise to answer your question. Yes, Lamayu Shriapu, it's not my area. But Alexander, I have just a quick question for you. What is geoeconomics, if not the use of economic instruments to achieve political ends?
Thank you, James. I can only give you the best illustration of it. Take the Belt and Road Initiative. The Belt and Road Initiative is what China is doing for the last decades to pull out hundreds of millions of poor in its own country, which made China world champion in this discipline. It's extending what is happening in China for the last decades, industrialization through large-scale infrastructure development. Now, it's internationalizing this development based on economic statecraft. So it's something different from the West. China applies a different model where the state still keeps a central position in the strategic direction of the economy, and also in order to provide public services, including education, as Rolf said, and also health. So it very massively invests into civilian infrastructure, not just military bases, if you understand what I mean by that, because other countries have up to 1,000 military bases on all over the world. And now the point is that really you can look into the figures. We'd always talk about debt trap, Trojan horse coming with Belt and Road Initiative, but to tell you the truth, the realities of the ground, again, if you check economic data, poverty reduction schemes is a different one. If you just look into Cold War scenarios, zero sum, and forge all our foreign policies in this way that is very much shaped by military think tanks, then of course, geoeconomics. But I give you a better illustration. Recently, NATO approached this in order to understand what is geoeconomics, and if we can contribute to the training of their senior officers in this area. So it's not me. I don't tell you it's not the civilian here. Even the military establishment per se is interested in it because it has negligeed this domain in the last decades.
Can I add something very, very shortly?
Greenwich, we can hardly hear you.
Can I add something very shortly?
Yes please.
Okay. The answer is very simple to this question. Russia has not been invited, period. And I understand the logic of the Chinese economic line, strategic line. Don't to put apples and oranges in one basket. The partnership is one thing, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization agreement is something different. So we have not been invited. We shouldn't say that our strategic dialogue with China is so ideal. We have also our problems and questions, which are being resolved in the framework of Shanghai agreement. By the way, China is not investing in Russia, which is an interesting point. So it's not so ideal economically. Mm-hmm. That's why I think that China is pursuing its own line, a strategic economic line in the region.
Yes.
Russia is cooperating with China on different platforms. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Gentlemen, I'm sorry, but I have to stop this our discussion here and move on to the third question.
Thank you very much for your answers. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Well, the third question sounds like that. What do you think states and the world community should do to prevent crisis and to promote cooperation in the future? Well, as I understand, there was some misunderstanding among our participants about the procedure. So Rolf basically touched upon this issue. So I don't know if you'd like to add something or we can move on, Rolf. No, nothing. Okay, Alexander.
No, we can move on. Let's move on.
Okay. Professor Malone?
Are you asking me about the third question?
Yes, the third question.
Yeah, well, just very, very brief amendments, and that's all. I think the diplomacy should be restored. That should be the main, methodology, how it would restore, how we could remedy the international situation. We do not have professionalism enough in diplomatic relations now. The real politics is almost there. The lack of confidence is here. So if I just putly and simply say that let's restore this, the principles of mutual confidence or mutual trust, that will be naive to say. The world is too complex or sometimes it's too cruel. As Golda Meir, one of the founders of Israel, used to say, our rivers of blood will not make the world shed a drop of tear. So this is a reality. So we must live in a real world. But the real world is demanding the mechanisms of finding the ways for the mutual balance of interests. That's the only way of how we could survive. And this finding, the process of finding the ways to restore the balance of interests should be established in practical terms. And that is the only way how we could really solve the situation, very gloomy situation which is have now. As for the multilateral machinery, I do not have a lot of trust in multilateral machinery, having been working for many years there, but still we do not have anything other. And we must use every potential to restore the real strength, potential strength of these multilateral mechanisms, including the UN, it is disarmament machinery, including other international multilateral platforms. That's the only way what we could do. And thirdly, of course, we must eliminate the immediate military threat. For that, we must establish the lines of communication which have been existing even during the Cold War era. That's the three points which I wanted to raise as for the first question. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Malone. I see Professor Morini.
Yes, here I am. Sorry for the delay. I had the technical problems this morning, early this morning. It never happened, but sorry, today happened.
Yeah. Mara, we just began to touch upon the third question. So if you'd like to share your thoughts on that, you're
the
welcome.
Third question, yes.
Third question, please.
The third question is yes. How to improve, let's say, future cooperation and to prevent crisis and to promote cooperation in the future. Yes, I prepared some slides that in any case I send you by email. So if you want to forward to your PhD students, to all the people, you can have a look. At the moment, I can tell you that I think that there are specific tools to promote, especially collaboration between states, which are based also on the relationship between private and public sectors. So involving, for instance, the role of some stakeholders in civil societies, of some enterprises, with the general political strategy of the public sector, in order to exchange also knowledges and to promote cooperation in the different fields of research, such as, for instance, technology. But there are also different strategies and tools which are often used in combination to avoid crises and to improve cooperation, which is tools that feature the strategy, which are related to the power mediation or for instance, the role of problem solving workshops, the issues of timing and ripeness in negotiation and mediation. And this could be very interesting aspects to apply if we want to try to promote cooperation. Obviously, it depends on the will of leaders, of governments in promoting cooperation in specific fields, which are not considered as a problem or a matter of discussion for defense security or military security. But I think that issues in the field of education, of technology, of information, of environment, and of some public policies of infrastructure, for instance, can improve the quality of relationship among states. And negotiation in the world of national interests meant balancing or trading the competing interests of states against one another, or finding common interests that could be the basis for agreement in the face of other conflicting interests. You know, you have to be pragmatic and to consider as a leader and of countries that there are different policy areas, different also battlefields, which can be considered as a matter of conflict, of course. But one strategy could be also the conflict transformation, that is how to move from a conflict situation to a better situation, a situation of negotiation, of solutions. And this is the effort to reach accommodation between parties in conflict through interactive processes that lead to reconciling tensions, redefining interests, or finding common ground. So, as I said, it's a question of will, it's a question of being open-minded, it's a question of culture, and obviously this is one important issue and topic which must be observed, monitored, and supported by any means of that are obviously in the field of cooperation and cooperation cooperation and collaboration. Sorry. So the best thing to prevent crisis, I think, it's a cultural approach, considering common ground and common interests, which can be developed, and being developed can create more cooperation among countries and more knowledge, awareness of their possibility of working together. Thank you.
Thank you, Mara. Thank you very much for your contribution. We are looking forward to having you at our discussion. Luckily, you're here. Okay, well, James, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Oleg. You have asked a necessarily abstract question. So, rather like Professor Malina, I am going to respond to it in a generic way. And I would confess, if you asked me these questions in 2011 rather than 2021, I'd probably respond in the same way. I think that at a time of rising danger between the principal powers or poles in the international system, like it or not, the question of cooperation moves into the background. But the question of how to prevent crises becomes very, very important. A crisis is always a sign of failure. It arises when one or both of the parties in a dispute are not sufficiently far-sighted to anticipate it in its dynamics and implications. Or it arises, and or it arises, when one or both of the parties fail to define and articulate their interests, their red lines, their underlying seriousness, clearly enough to be understood and accepted by the interlocutor. And it often arises when one side or when there is a great imbalance of power. Nothing leads to war more ineluctably than the steady decline of relative power. When one side to a dispute is maintaining political aims that it cannot sustain because its position is visibly weakening, that makes crises more likely. When, on the other hand, one country concludes, tomorrow I will not be able to go to war, but today I can, that is also very worrying. This is part of the whole dynamic that led to the First World War, if you are inside the German general staff, and you're looking at the economic growth of Russia and some other factors. That's the whole dynamic. And in Austria, it's even worse at the time. So I could see elements of that now. Now, the balance of my remarks, I don't know whether I will sound more like Sun Tzu or like a page from the British Army Manual. Sun Tzu said that if you know yourself but not your enemy, you will win some battles, but you certainly will not win all of them. But if you know neither yourself nor your enemy, you will lose every battle. So there are some rules of good housekeeping here that are very important. First of all, understand what your own aim is. This sounds obvious, but it often hasn't been. What is your political aim? To say, our aim is stopping violence. No, I'm sorry. If you're talking about complex situations, what political end state are you trying to achieve? And then what follows from that? What means do you have to achieve it? If you don't have the means to achieve that aim, should you have that aim in the first place? Should you be articulating it? Should you be standing on a platform like Hillary Clinton did and say, Assad must go? If you have no intention and no political aim of doing anything about it. If you are rightly concerned about the scale of intellectual property theft by China from the Western world, but your own regulatory system is inadequate. You have not revised your intellectual property laws in 30 years. What do you expect to happen? The same is true of money laundering or anything else. In any respect, your means must be brought into alignment with your aims, no matter how exemplary your aims are. Know your enemy, number two, figuratively, because the point applies as much to problematic partners and problematic allies and good allies. And the only way you do that is that you take your own normative assumptions and you put them away. And you try to understand as much as possible how the issue looks from the other side, how the other side thinks. What is his political culture? What is his strategic culture? What are his economic interests? How do these things mesh up or diverge? And this is not necessarily with the aim of producing compromise, simply to understand what you're dealing with. It is this effort that makes statecraft the art of the possible. And if you don't make that effort and you don't succeed, then statecraft just becomes art for art's sake. And third point, I think it's come up in other ways. When we have a complex of issues that defines our antagonism, and this is true of Russia and the West on the one hand, and increasingly of China and the West on the other, do not conflate them. Look at the Biden administration's list of sanctions with regard to Navalny. If you read the State Department's official statement, it wisely ties these things not to Russia's domestic affairs and not to Navalny personally, but to Russia's violation of the Chemical Weapons Convention. In that way, it's doing something which is fundamental to disentangle the internal issue, which many would argue, and I wouldn't be one of them, is not our proper business. From what is our proper business, which is another country's conduct and policy in international affairs. The same is true of dealing with China. If you want to address the critical issue of Hong Kong, where Chinese conduct stands in violation of an interstate agreement that has been lodged with the UN, or with Taiwan, where similar points can be made, you will get nowhere by coupling this discussion with the question of Xinjiang, which is not an international issue, horrendous and odious as it is. This is an essential discipline we all have to learn to adopt. And it's not just one particular country or side that learns needs to adopt this, because the problem is widespread. And my final point, I've made it elsewhere, and I'll just make it very briefly in other sessions we have had. Invest in expertise, incorporate experts, both state experts and independent experts, into your own decision-making cycle. Experts have no place making policy decisions, but they must be at the top table that deliberates upon them before they are made. And a key job of experts, whether they are government or private or independent experts, is to tell their political masters things they do not wish to hear. And I'll close there. Thank you.
Thank you, James. A lot of food to think about and to talk about. Well, now I'd like to open the floor for discussion. We have maybe 10 minutes to exchange your views and ask questions from the audience. You may use chat also for questions. There's a question from Gagzot. Gagzot, are you asking somebody in particular?
Good morning, everyone. My question is addressed for all speakers who wants to answer this question.
Okay. So, dear colleagues, can you read question in the chat, please? Maybe somebody...
No. Could you formulate it? Because I have some technical problems.
Okay.
Ah, yes. Here we go.
Could you...
Can you ask...
Could you make it verbal? Could you make it verbal?
Yes, exactly.
Can you make it short, please?
Yes, my question is related to the relations between the United States and Russia. How to break the impasse between the United States and Russia on stage? Thank you very much.
How to break the impasse between US and Russia? That's the question. Yes, James, please.
I don't think we will break the impasse, but I think one has to understand that an impasse is not necessarily dangerous because it's an impasse. An impasse can exist for highly legitimate and intelligent reasons. The question is how it's managed and whether or not it's managed intelligently. And I think Andrei made some points earlier, which would be very similar to mine, although when it comes to a lot of dialogue, I think a lot of that is taking place, but the military dialogue talks about is extremely important. But still, this is a kind of discussion one can have. Until the US-Russia situation, and it's not just US, because it is much of Europe, much of the EU. This reflects very real differences of interest and world views. And as long as these things are in place, and as long as on both sides in Moscow, in Washington, in Brussels, people feel that these positions can be sustained, the impasse will remain an impasse. And it's better than conflict, and certainly better than war.
Okay. Thank you, James. Anybody else? Yes.
Very briefly.
Yes.
I agree with James that the impulse should be carefully and smartly managed. That's the only thing we could do now under the circumstances. But still, I think, and I hope, and I stress that once again, as soon as we are really within the strategic dialogue, a new round of it, then a kind of a new space could be opened for us. I hope so. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. Mara,
yes, I agree with my colleagues of the topic of the impasse, but I think that the relationship between Russia and the United States will never change, because the United States needs to have such kind of approach, assertive foreign policy against Russia, because it's still in its mind, the question of the impossibility to create a new paradigm in international relations and also in foreign policies towards Russia. So they still think as if Russia was the Soviet Union, if it was the only enemy in the world, the only threat in the world. They didn't realize that a better relationship with Russia could be the real direction to stop the threat by China. This is, I think, the most important issues.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mara. Alexander, yes, please.
I would like to provide a complementary perspective. When we talk about impasse, who decides whether it is an impasse? Who is declaring it's us? How is declared? And how do we check that this is actually the reality? You know, in security studies, there is a very important distinction between about threats. Threats can be real or just perceived. And here I join everything that has been said so far. So as long as somebody talks about an impasse, that's not really dangerous. The question is, but however, how do we check how this is being done and how all the societies run after? What anybody is declaring out there, including the mass media and news outlets. How's this done? Or can we just talk about something? Somebody puts that in the pipeline and mainstreams it all across society. You know, I have been starting my career as a young scholar, specialized in democratic control of armed forces. That's how I started. Something completely exotic, right? When you're in the military, but in every liberal democracy, and as long as you talk about it, there must be democratic oversight and civilian control. And I want to have any major threat on the table with independent parliamentary commissions and judicial review in case of conflict. And not just anybody coming after and say, this is it, goodbye. This is not how democracy works. And as long as we insist, democratic values, liberal democratic blah, blah, norms and values, we also have to be credible and say, hello, guys, how do we do this? And how is the public scrutiny checked? So because then, if this is not done, if constitutional rule of law does not apply to the security sector anymore, neither in China nor in Russia nor in the West, then we can prepare for the next world war, for sure.
Thank you, Alexander. There is a question in the chat that came from Lorenzo. Let me read it for those who cannot see it in the chat. The question sounds like this. Do you think the renewal of the START-3 agreement could be a base on which to build a new cooperative relation between Moscow and Washington, at least in the arms control sector? This is the first question. Who would like to answer this one? Andrei Yurich, please.
Could you repeat the first half of the question, please?
Do you think the renewal of the START-3 agreement could be a base on which to build a new cooperative relation between Moscow and Washington, at least in arms control sector?
Yes and no. The answer is yes and no. Yes, because in the arms control, possibly yes. But generally, I'm not sure that it could influence the whole spectrum of relations. That's a very short question, answer to your question.
Okay, thank you. Yes, James.
With respect to the first question, I would say more no than yes. And that is because possibly both of the key actors, certainly Russia, do not take the view, though President Obama did, that arms control is somehow contagious. Russia has insisted on looking at every single weapons category separately, and it has its own set of objectives, which are at times fundamentally different from the other side. So I don't think the one thing leads to the other. From my personal perspective, the more interesting question is the strategic autonomy question. Problem is that one problem we have is that there is almost deliberate imprecision in Europe about what this term means. Some people have talked about what is to me a more satisfying term, but also imprecise, strategic responsibility. There is obviously an existential question here, which I raised. Supposing the apocalypse comes to visit us and the United States decides not to be there, what does Europe do? So there is a case, if you are dealing with the real world and hard strategic and military issues, for Europe to acquire capability to act on its own military. If you look even at the Libya operation, which was conducted overwhelmingly by EU participants, you will see a glaring lack of capability and interconnections between all key components. And to overcome this would require considerably higher defense budgets than any of the current advocates of strategic autonomy are willing to accept. And it would require a progression and continuation of this over a period of years. And if you are talking about something else, then you are just talking about a vision without any substance. You are not being serious. So, this is going to lead to more dispute, more confusion, more lack of clarity where clarity is needed, but it's not something I expect to see emerge.
Thank you, James. There is another question from Lorenzo. Let me read it. If the EU reaches the strategic autonomy by the USA, this could improve the dialogue between the Russian Federation and European countries? Question mark. Who would like to address this question? Yes.
Firstly, I doubt greatly that Europe would gain strategic autonomy from the USA. And that's the answer to the question.
Okay. Yes, Mara, please.
Yes, I agree. It's also because Biden's strategy and in his speech is to remind to the system of alliance and to the leaders of the European Union that America has been back. And so it's a way to say, please don't take any initiative with the Russian leaders, with Russian governments, especially in the field and the topic of vaccine diplomacy, as we can see for the registration and demands also in Italy for Sputnik vaccine. So I think that it will probably not work, but it's true that if the European Union would be free to and would be more autonomous politically, especially could have better relationship with Russia, but I don't think that there are political issues and ideological issues and the political orientation of the European Union to follow such a direction. I think that it will be always in the sphere, in the American sphere, and this is a problem, of course, for the relationship with Russia in the international setting, and for the reshaping also of the new international order as well.
Thank you, Mara, for your answer. Well, I see there are no more questions. No? Yeah, Alexander, please.
The only thing that I would like to add in this, really add up to what has been already said, is that from strategic responsibility, it's important to strategic autonomy, which might be important for Europe. There's also the question about having actually a strategic culture of its own. Europe has no strategic culture of its own. And to be very precise about this, it's that it doesn't have a continental European strategy. It might have an Atlantic, yes, but not a continental, Middle European strategy. So it doesn't have a strategy to look to the east at all. That's dangerous. That's all.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Alexander. Well, is there anybody else who would like to make some concluding remarks and we'll have to wrap up? No? No? Okay, well, let me on behalf of the audience and myself to thank our experts, professors who took part in the discussion and then made their great contribution. I think that our students have in all countries, I don't mean only in Russia, have a better insight into the issue that we've covered today. I understand that there's much to be left and to talk about, and I do hope that we'll have more opportunities to get together and talk about that. I wish everybody well, be healthy, and hope to see you again at some point in the future. Goodbye.
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 Goodbye. Thank you.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.